And Palm Island is not a place that many Australians would have heard of before the year 2004. The remote tropical island was once a penal colony and is now home to around 3,000 people. 11 years ago, though, there was a series of brutal and tragic events on that island that would see the island make national news. Shocking images of a police station burning and residents rioting sent shockwaves around the country. Today, the island is a much more peaceful place, but for the people of Palm, the scars of the past are still far from healed.
Indigenous people have for a long time experienced a deep injustice, and that very few people have the opportunity to do something about that.
It's almost unbelievable that state police would act that way, violently entering the homes and violently arresting people.
The raids, I think it was more devastating than the riot itself.
Palm Island is a tropical Indigenous community off the coast of North Queensland. The death of a young Indigenous man while in police custody and the events that followed shone a spotlight on the troubled relationship between Indigenous people and the police in Queensland.
I was about 9 years of age when the raids happened, when the police came in.
I thought that Dad had died, or, you know, they were going to kill him. I never forget what had happened that morning.
This would never happen in a white community or a white suburban community. Guns pointed to children's head.
In a groundbreaking case, Lex Wotton is suing the Queensland State Government for racial discrimination for what happened here on the island 11 years ago.
It's a class action brought on behalf of the people on Palm Island, and it will focus on racial discrimination, but there are probably some underlying issues, I think, which affects everybody, and those are really about the power of the state and the power of the police, and what are the checks and balances in place.
It started on the morning of the 19th of November 2004, when Senior Sergeant Christopher Hurley arrested 36-year-old Murungi Dumaji for swearing. Within an hour, he was dead. An autopsy would later reveal he had injuries similar to those of a car crash: four broken ribs, a ruptured portal vein, and a liver cleaved in two. Multiple coronial inquests and a trial would later clear Hurley of manslaughter and assault. But at the time, the town wasn't being told how or why this had happened.
People were very angry and knew that he didn't have those injuries before he went into jail.
After the death, there was only one sort of conclusion that the community could come to, and that was that he died at the hands of a police or somebody in the watch house.
The community made multiple attempts to get the Queensland Premier, Police Commissioner or Minister to come to the island and consult with them over the death.
We put a resolution forward asking them to come, but they ignored the community.
Journalist Tony Kosh was reporting on Palm Island at the time and is a vocal critic of the actions of the police.
But the actual investigation and questioning of the police who were involved was absolutely appalling.
A week after the death, a community meeting was called to hear the results of Murungi Dumaji's autopsy. The death was declared an accident.
We wanted to know, but we accept this as an accident.
That's when the uproar happened. And the whole community went right around the whole community.
God, he's going to look for the easy way out. We want him to keep him alive and torment him every day of the week in prison.
By 3 p.m. that day, the police station, police barracks and home of Senior Sergeant Chris Hurley were burning. Police declared an emergency situation, flying in special emergency response teams and increasing the police presence from 22 to 100.
These are experienced police officers and they were genuinely in fear of their lives.
We are not going to allow for the torching of buildings in Australia.
It is a concern for police that there are weapons stored on the island. It's also a concern to police that there is a lot of alcohol on the island.
On the news that night, this footage of Lex Wotton was broadcast across the nation, branding him as the ringleader.
You know, Lex spoke the loudest, you know, and he was telling the people to get up and have their say.
Well, after the riot, everybody went home. You know, everything was quiet. The whole island was quiet after that.
He called us all to the lounge room and said, you know, I'll be leaving for a while. They're going to come and get me first.
The next day, the raids began at dawn.
I looked at the window. I saw all the gunmen standing around the house. That's when I saw Dad. He had his hands up and he was on his knees being tasered and hit with a stun gun. Also, we were on the ground shaking like he was taking a fit. I started screaming, singing that to my mum. They shot Dad, they shot Dad. I thought that Dad had died.
He was sitting at the table waiting for them. They surround him, he puts his hands up and they taser him. You know, it was just absolutely inflammatory. It was a lot of cowboy stuff.
All around the island, houses were raided over the coming days, with pregnant women and children held at gunpoint. Many had nothing to do with the riot.
I was with all my brothers and we were all playing hide and seek at two buses full of the SWAT members running out with balaclavas and full riot gear, and the officer came running behind me shouting, "Get on the ground, get on the ground." I was very scared and I had to drop on the ground. He told me to put my face in the dirt. I saw the gun pointing straight at my forehead, so I ended up putting my head straight down in the dirt.
There was no need for this Alsatian dogs and balaclavas and tasers and kicking doors in. They were just having a terrorism practice session and using an unarmed passive island as their victim.
Because they had detained 5 or 6 of them on Palm, so I said I'd find out where they were being held. I wanted to get in touch with those that were being flown off just to advise them of their rights.
Russell Parker was arrested and detained without access to a lawyer.
They separated us from, you tell us what we want, what we know, then we'll let you go. You know, can we have legal service? Yeah, they're on the way, she's on her way.
They weren't allowing us access to our clients. I couldn't believe the treatment we were getting.
What about legal representation? I mean, hadn't anybody read the deaths in custody report from the early 90s?
They probably came back probably 10 minutes after or something like 10. I said, oh God, can we go now? No. Yeah, you can go, you're going to town.
17 Palm Islanders were arrested over the riot, and whilst many were never convicted, strict bail conditions meant some were kept from their families and homes for years. In 2007, 4 men still facing charges over the riot were found not guilty. A year later, Lex Wotton was given a 7-year sentence.
Nobody was injured, and yet the way they were treated, the way they were not granted bail, not allowed to come back to the island, you know, therefore not allowed to, able to give support to their families, was just so discriminatory and so appalling.
After serving 20 months, Lex Wotton was released and placed under a gag order, forbidden from speaking in public or to the media until mid-2014.
This court is now resumed. Please be seated.
This federal court hearing on Palm Island is giving him and many others a chance to tell their side.
Well, this, my daughter Shanara, that gave evidence. My children have been affected and they had to live with a lot too, and maybe if there is a good outcome, it might bring some type of relief to the family.
Getting my voice out, you know, for the judge to hear and how we felt and stuff, it was real good.
Chavez Morton is now 19 years old. The events of 2004 still affect him and his family.
He was always looking over his shoulders. He was a kid that never did.
When I'm sleeping, it just comes into my dream and I just jump out of my sleep. It's just the flashbacks of the officer standing over me with the big assault rifle just pointing at my forehead. I've tried to gain my confidence back with the police, but still I get scared. And
I think as a community, we sort of won that, stood up, that sort of made the police aware of, you know, don't come throwing your weight around. You're isolated, so you know you tend to work with the community, not against.
Yeah, there have been a lot of positive things, and you can see there's a A lot of development has happened on the island over the last 3.5 years. Day to day, we drive around the island with generally very little trouble.
The reality is there's a lot of good people on Palm Island, a lot of good people who really want to interact with the police and help improve their community. And that's no different to any other community that I've been in. People want their kids to grow up safely in a safe environment.
The first 2 weeks of the trial are over, with proceedings continuing early next year, where the police will take the stand. The Palm Island community is asking for damages and an apology.
Just man up as the government and, admit there were wrongs committed, and let's all move forward.
But people are hopeful that this landmark case against the Queensland government will bring some sort of resolution and peace to Palm Island.
Maybe they'll start listening, start hearing our voices. I don't know, I'm just hoping it's all for the best.
Ultimately, what happens here, it will make police officers, the police force and perhaps the state think differently about their powers and the way they act in future if ever there are instances like this that occur again.
I've never had the opportunity to tell my story, to try and right some wrongs in this country and in this state, that institutional racism exists and we have to get rid of it.
That story was produced by Laura Murphy-Oates, camera work and editing by Mark Tadich, and the feed did request interviews with the police commissioner and various Queensland state government departments, and they declined to speak on camera. Queensland police did, however, provide us with a statement. They said they are considering recommendations from the Supreme Court of Appeal's decision.